the Awards My Deep Son has come out for us this morning. This lecture is a little bit about the course details. It's called How We Train You to Become a Doctor. So they say, great to see you all here. My name is Jamie Coleman. I'm Professor of Medicine and Medical Education here. I'm the Deputy Head of the programme, and as I'll come on to, I'm also lead at the moment at the third year, which is the first clinical year. Of course, I'm a lecturer, so I have some learning outcomes. Here we are. I've all the lectures and stuff like this. So what do I want to do? Try and understand what drives teaching and learning here on the programme. To actually just tell you a little bit about the teaching and assessment methods used here in Birmingham, and I might give some relevance about where they vary from, for example, other courses around the UK. And then briefly, just out of interest, is to recognise the importance of advances in medicine and how my job is to keep the curriculum up to date. Much of what I'm going to talk about is a massive team effort here. Of course, I'm fortunate enough to work with a lot of committed and enthusiastic scientists, clinicians, educational specialists and administrators to deliver this particular course. So, if the building could talk, it would say this is our mission, aspire to train the very best doctors through a distinctive curriculum to be safe, competent, good communicators and well equipped to meet the challenges of tomorrow's NHS. We hope our students will graduate with an inquiring mind that will challenge and innovate future medical knowledge and practice. But we also recognise that life interests outside of medicine, probably the enhanced quality of being a doctor will be nurtured and enhanced, and students will look back on their undergraduate time in Birmingham as one of the best years of their life. And I'm a Birmingham graduate, and I certainly fondly remember sort of my studies, and now I'm sort of back and working here. It's a sort of great environment to be in. I still love the place. So just to set the scene, we're one of the largest medical schools in the UK, depending on how you count them, and we've now some of the independent medical schools. There are 33 or so medical schools around all of the UK, and we're sort of there in the, sort of, I think, the third largest, with 374 contracted students. That's 334 on our five-year course and 40 students on our graduate entry course. And actually, this makes a huge contribution to the undergraduate in terms of teaching in the university as a whole. We're very fortunate in a way, because of the region that we live in, to have a complex and diverse NHS, because actually that means that we have plenty of placement providers, as I'll come on to in a short while. A large region with sort of diverse ethnicity and social mix. My job is to create what I call day one foundation year one doctors, and so actually we need to have very good relationships with our deanery and pass our students quite naturally on to then their postgraduate training. We do that by having regular meetings and understanding who I have a very close interface with our deanery team here in the West Midlands. We have about 130 clinically trained academics, so like myself or whatever else, but actually quite a lot of the course delivery is done by a much wider range of honorary academic staff, including our placement providers, our GPs and our hospital consultants and others. Running this place is a bit like a sort of air traffic control at Heathrow to know where all the students are at any one stage. So actually, of course, we have to have a huge administrative engine, and that requires about 55 full-time equivalents in our sort of our office and general administration staff, which includes the quality team. But of course, as it were, we're embedded in a research-rich college, the Medical and Dental Sciences, within college throughout the university. And again, hopefully, you'll get a chance to see how research influences our curriculum. So a bit of an overview of our curriculum as a whole. As it says on here, because of the Competition and Marketing Authority, apparently I've had to put up this thing which says the modules listed on our website may occasionally be subject to change. So this is the rider. Actually, I would say to you that if our curriculum doesn't change, I failed. Because if in 5 years' time, things are exactly the same as they are now, it means that people like me haven't adapted to what's happening in healthcare generally, what the technological advances, whatever else. So I can guarantee our curriculum will change. I make no apologies for that. If it doesn't, then I'll have to leave or something. But the general shape will probably not change vastly. MBCHB, Bachelor of Medicine, Bachelor of Surgery. It's not that we can't spell something, it's Latin, isn't it? So you'll find that MBBS, MBCHB are pretty equivalent. So effectively there's two bachelor's degrees that make up course to course. But it's a bit more than just medicine and surgery. In fact, the GMC say that we must have at least general practice of obstetrics, pediatrics and psychiatry. But even that is relatively small compared to the palette of general specialties that will actually our students experience here during the curriculum. And what I'll do is I'll give you an overview now of how they translate into our different phases of the programme and therefore into our different years. So we actually split things, and although the graduate entry course, for people that are interested in that, there's the first year is slightly different, but it contains most of the same as the phase one of the principal course. This is where there's building, synthesising and applying the medical knowledge base. So it is some of the sort of what might have been classed pre-clinical. As I'll come on to, there is clinical elements in here as well. So from that science base, we then move into my year, which is around acquiring and utilising medical information as students start to get used to the history taking, the physical examination, investigations and diagnostics that underpin the general sort of clinical process. In year four, we broaden the professional base, as you'll see, through a mixture of medical and surgical specialties. And then lastly, managing the patient sick and well. So let's just have a look at those phases just in sort of brief. So each of our first 2 years contain a mixture of what we would class as biological sciences as well as our medicine in society program. So the green ones here are our systems-based modules. So we don't study anatomy and biochemistry separately. We bring all of these elements together, for example, to study neuroscience in our neurons and synapses. As I say, there will then be the sociological aspects, so people, patients and population, where we actually get people to understand a little bit about epidemiology and, for example, the NHS. And each of the semesters, they will have three of the biological sciences and one medicine and society. Underneath this, then we have community-based medicine. So right from week one in our course, our students go out to general practice every fortnight, and that continues actually for the first 4 years. They'll go out every fortnight to general practice, and then in the fifth year, there's a more consolidated block. Professional academic skills, very important that our students, sort of, as it were, understand that being a doctor is more just about the knowledge, it's about, sort of, as it were, general skills, including lifelong learning, so they underpin this, and that includes some problem-based learning, which I'll come on to, is a relatively small but important component of our course. And then regional anatomy. And this makes sense in terms of regional anatomy, because here we've got the respiratory medicine in semester two of the first year, and we've got cardiovascular system in the first semester of the second year. Now, I don't know, but when I went to medical school, the heart and the lungs were relatively close together. I don't know if anyone's noticed this. So clearly, if we didn't have some regional anatomy to bring the thoracic anatomy together, then we'd be in trouble. So we need to have that as well. And the second year is much the same. You can see more systems here and more of the medicine in society. And again, the same underpinning longitudinal strands, including our professional academic skills. Third year is where the students mainly go sort of out into the hospitals and undertake longer blocks. These are sort of 2-3 month blocks approximately in hospital-based medicine and surgery. These are in different trusts around the West Midlands area. And underpinning this is also clinical sciences. These are the hematology, immunology, biochemistry, infection that underpin diagnostic medicine. So this is where we start thinking about diagnostics. And again, our students are going out to community-based medicine once a fortnight, even in the third year. Two different other components in our third year, evidence-based medicine, so that our students know how to interpret new evidence that's coming out, which is, again, part of lifelong learning. And then the students get together and actually undertake project piece work in the health improvement evidence review. At the bottom here, you see our clinical skills passport, actually a passport that's been adopted by our Keele and Warwick universities because Birmingham, they thought it was quite good, so that's nice. The procedural skills passport is something that our students will take with them throughout the next few years. And this includes teaching and simulation and then observed practice and all the skills that are actually outlined that we need to make sure that our students are competent at doing, taking blood all the way through to much more invasive procedures. And I'll come on briefly to procedures in a short while. Year four broadens our professional base. Now these are undertaken in a rotation, but we have psychiatry, neurology, surgery and perioperative care, which includes some surgical specialties such as orthopedics and trauma, and then specialty medicine, which is a much longer block and tries to bring integrate things such as diabetes, elderly care, ophthalmology, renal medicine, cardiology. So many of our specialties are all taught here in one slightly longer block in one trust, so that actually our students can also think about multimorbidity and bringing all these sort of specialties together. There's a teaching project in there, and there's also an audit, which is part of, again, professional competence that ends up in a teaching, in a conference poster. And year four is a bit more self-directed. Whilst they come back in year three to lectures, actually year four is underpinned by a lot of electronic lectures, just-in-time learning, a progress sort of log so that our students can do that, and a lot more self-regulated learning. By this stage, actually, our students are pretty good at knowing what they need to learn. By the way, you have noticed I've skipped over these things called exams. Generally, students don't like exams, so I thought I'd ignore those for a bit back on one slide later. At the end of the fourth year, our students then sort of elect to go away on their elective studies, so that's a 6 to 8 week period of where they can select to go anywhere in the world to undertake their elective. And then they come back at the beginning of the fifth year to undertake a selected career experience. Careers are actually very important, and of course, going and being a doctor is one thing, but actually, essentially, as soon as our doctors finish here, they're sort of a pluripotent stem cell to go out anywhere they want to do anything they want in careers. And quite often they won't have had the opportunity to undertake a particular area they might be very interested in pathology, but they may not spend any time in a lab and they don't know whether that's what they want to do. So actually we give them a period where they can have three, and some people elect to do a little bit more, 4 weeks or so of a selected career experience. Then what we have in the fifth year is sort of two halves of the year, so these are obviously again taken in rotation. Half of it is sort of, you might say, managing the patients when they're well. This might include obstetrics, because we don't think pregnancy is a disease, so that's quite important. They have obs and gynae. CBM, the general practice there, community-based medicine, where again our students will be much more independent, and yes, whilst they'll be seeing some ill patients, whatever else, they're actually also thinking about health and keeping people healthy, and then the pediatrics block. So that's half of the fifth year. And then the other half, which we've now amalgamated our sort of medicine, surgery, trauma, emergency department medicine, and our intensive care medicine into what we call the acutely ill patient. Because actually these days, what we need, as soon as they qualify as doctors, to be able to deal with patients, whether they come in with abdominal pain, it's not necessarily a medical or a surgical case, it's the problem that they have. If they're acutely unwell, they need to be able to deal with that. And that actually maps very closely with now what they'll go on to do in the foundation program curriculum, which is as soon as they qualify, they'll then be continuing their postgraduate training. Right after the end of exams, we then have a student clinical assistantship. And this is really a time where our students can be much more independent. They'll be undertaking night shifts, they'll be refreshing their skills, they'll be trying to think about ways of developmental activities that will really make sure that on the first Wednesday of August, they are safe, competent to undertake what they are very prepared for the work they need to undertake. So that's the general shape of the curriculum. What drives teaching and learning? Well, actually, what drives teaching and learning is our regulator, the General Medical Council. That is very important. And actually, my Bible is Here Tomorrow's Doctor 2009. It's likely to be updated next year, in which case we may have a minor curriculum analysis and maybe refresh if necessary. But this underpins three areas: a doctor, a scholar, and a scientist, as practitioner and professional. Of course, what really drives our learning is our patients, and again, what we try and make sure is we involve patients at all stages. And also, we try and make sure that our students get experiences not just outside community-based medicine and hospital-based medicine, but actually they get some exposure in other areas of sort of community-based care. What we do know is, and sort of put this in the last couple of years or whatever else, is that we're very keen. Care, of course, is very important, and what we need to do is try and make sure our students think about good care, and sometimes that may be helpful by having a look at, for example, where things aren't necessarily so good. Communication is very important. Here, the patient was seen by a junior doctor, prescribed medication, perhaps not very well, came in, maybe a diagnostic error. Here, the junior doctor was rude to the family, but then informed that their mother had died. here didn't feel the junior fully understood the husband's condition. So we made great pains here to really try and think about those professional skills of communication, whatever else, to make sure that hopefully none of our junior doctors will be in the position of, you know, be exposed to the sort of culture that has unfortunately been part of some care in the past. So yes, we need to produce doctors that are technically competent, but also demonstrate the virtues and values and compassion and empathy of the profession as a whole. It says here, changing a bedpan, taking a blood sample aren't simply objective tasks. You can do them in ways which are empowering or soothing, or ways which are demeaning and disrespectful. So actually, whilst we have a set of core sort of values that are relevant for every medical student, we've made it very clear that we will have values that underpin, for example, some of the six C's: compassion, communication, courage, commitment, and competence. So we've actually thought about this. Now, it's incumbent upon me, we're only meant to, of course, qualify people that we think are fit to become doctors. Actually, in the past, that's always been done by identifying behaviours that aren't fit to be doctors, which is perhaps a slightly negative, I was classed like the iPhone warranty, where you scroll to the bottom and say, yes, I accept, whatever else. You know, you've got all of these things that people tell you you should do, but you perhaps don't, or you're not so aware of them. So actually, we've been trying to spend a bit of time working with our student body to actually try and exemplify what learning to be a doctor is like, about, for example, taking best use of learning opportunities, contribution, and really trying to think about what values are instilled in the profession. For anyone that hasn't applied already, because I know that I have met one or two people that must have had their applications in this week, but you're about to apply, if you come to, or in fact, for those that have applied for a multimedia interview, there's this booklet here, which is Welcome to Medicine. I've got the 2014, but the 2015 one is now out. I would suggest you have a look at this. Whilst this is designed for, as it were, the students when they come in and we give them a copy of this, it's actually a really good exposition, as it were, about some of the core and professional values that are in here. There are some interesting things as well that I quite like. I usually read this out. Making the most of your time at medical school, it says in here. Don't be distracted by how well others are doing. Medicine is a competitive subject of study, and your fellow students, that's some of the people here, will be some of the brightest in the country. So you may find it's not as easy to stay ahead as it was at school. Try not to worry how your performance compares with your peers. Instead, focus on doing the best you can. Remember that a fundamental part of being a good doctor is the ability to work in a team and a willingness to reflect on your own practice. And actually, it is a side problem for us, actually, because we have the brightest people in the country or whatever else come here, is actually understanding, as it were, that no longer are they the top of the class or whatever else, head boy, head girl, that actually they are amongst all of the head boys and head girls, and all of the tops of the class around the whole country can be difficult. And actually we have a little bit within our professional academic skills where we try and make knowledge of that. We tell students about, you know, actually it's fine these days to be there and to be a passing doctor because you're here and you're in a competitive environment. So a few more things about what makes Birmingham unique. What the previous dean called a Birmingham stamp, and I like to think it's first class, of course. What other things? Well, I think exposed to and inspired by advances in research. And while some of our students will undertake, for example, a more research-based integrated degree, actually research impinges obviously on quite a lot of the teaching that we do, but there's also other things like research projects, deep dive issues where students will go out and do working with a researcher a bit more. And so right from the first year, we're very keen that our students understand that the research, of course, underpins modern knowledge in medicine. Various courses throughout the country will have a different emphasis on community-based medicine. I think we have an appropriate emphasis. We know that about 50% of our graduates will end up becoming general practitioners, generally, because that's the way things are. And so actually having general practice embedded throughout the 5 years, again, is very important to us. And I think we have an excellent community-based learning scheme here at Birmingham. This wasn't me, although actually I was relatively responsible for this, but excellence in prescribing skills training. These days, actually, before every graduate in the country can qualify, they have to undertake a prescribing exam, and that's for, yes, all 7,500 medical students or so throughout the country. And we have a very strong tradition of teaching to try and make sure that our students are competent for that. The fact that actually I set the national exam for all 7,000 medical students throughout the country also helps our students, I think. And then lastly, exposure to world-class facilities. Of course, the QE, but many of the other facilities around the region actually really top class in terms of, and our students will all get the chance to go to many of these, and indeed, one of our aims is to make sure that all of our students will have a placement at the QE and just see the breadth, and I'll come on a bit of the QE in a short while. So teaching and learning, well, we're in lecture theatre. You can go to every medical school and most lecture theatres will look the same. That's because large group teaching and large group lectures, of course, occurs throughout most sort of medical courses. We do things, our students are all issued a sort of clicker, so we sometimes have quizzes and all sorts of other things here, so that the audience can't go to sleep and have to respond appropriately. I'll actually see whether anyone's asleep at the moment, but there's small group tutorials. Of course, they underpin, so they will underpin some of the knowledge in the large group lectures, and they may include some problem-orientated learning, and then there's an element of independent or private study. So that's not different from many other courses. What is potentially different is some added extras. I mentioned problem-based learning. Some medical schools have gone entirely towards a problem-based learning. In fact, some of those are swinging back. I think we have probably about up to 10% of problem-based learning, which is very important for us, but it can't be the only thing that underpins our learning. Inquiry is very important for medicine generally, but actually there's some knowledge as well that needs to be gained. So we will have part of that embedded. Anatomy teaching, you can see here of the anatomy prosectorium. So we don't do dissection at Birmingham, and in fact fewer than a third of medical schools throughout the country do, but we actually allow pre-dissected specimens as well as three-dimensional anatomy, lots of other different anatomy in here, I'll come on to that, and community-based medicine. So there are some differences in terms of what we do in phase one. We know that learning is different at university from school, and again, as I say, we've got a learning medicine stranded through professional academic skills in year one, so actually our students understand how they can transition from perhaps A-level learning through to university learning and lifelong learning as a doctor. Moving on rapidly. Third year. Now third year is the one I'm responsible for. I love this quote. Starting third year is like going to a foreign country. You don't speak the language, you don't understand the customs, and the natives aren't necessarily friendly. I know that's not always true without learning. We actually now prepare our students, and in the GMC guidance on preparing students, I was quite pleased that they actually bring out a course that I introduced some years ago, where actually our second year, before they go off on their holiday after their exams, spend a week or two as part of our hospital preparation course, orientating them, trying to segue them nicely from their preclinical learning, more so into their hospital-based learning. And we have other ways of doing that throughout the course as well. Now, some people may have seen this. I thought I'd show you a bit about hospital-based teaching. Let's just have a look. I'm usually bored by this point, so I'll see whether this works.
Morning, Sir Lancelot.
Morning.
Morning, gentlemen.
Good morning, sir.
Not late, I hope.
Not at all, sir.
I suppose you've got another half dozen boring cholecystectomies today.
Yes, sir.
After last night, I feel like one myself. How about that gastrectomy I did yesterday?
Not so well, sir.
Oh. Pity. Great pity. Morning, sister.
Morning, sir. Morning, sir.
Everything ready?
All ready, sir.
Splendid. Now, you just lie still, old fellow. I'm just going to discuss your case with these young doctors here. Take your pajamas off, sister. You. Examine his abdomen. Take that grubby fist away. The first rule of diagnosis, gentlemen. Eyes first and most. Hands next and least. Tongue not at all. Look! Have you looked?
Yes, sir.
See anything?
No, sir.
Very good. Carry on. Gently, man. Gently. You're not making bread. Don't forget, to be a successful surgeon, you need the eye of a hawk, the heart of a lion, and the hands of a lady. You find it?
Yes, sir.
Well, what is it?
A lung.
Well, what do you make of it? Is it kidney? Is it spleen? Is it liver? Is it dangerous? Don't worry, my good man. You won't understand our medical talk. You, what are we going to do about it?
Cut it out, man. Cut it out. Where shall we make the incision?
Nothing like large enough. Keyhole surgery. Damnable. Couldn't see anything. Like this.
I don't
Now, you. When we've cut through the skin, what's the first substance we shall find?
Subcutaneous fat, sir.
Quite right. And then we come across the surgeon's worst enemy, which is what?
Speak up, man! Blood, you numbskull! You cut a patient, he bleeds until the processes of nature form a clot and stop it.
This interval is known scientifically as the bleeding time.
You, what's the bleeding time?
10 past 10, sir.
I'm sure some parents may think that that's doctor in the house, of course, very traditional sort of bedside teaching, so long as lots of out there. So apparently teaching by humiliation is no longer allowed. But actually, probably some ways things don't change too much, because of course bedside teaching is still terribly important. So as a consultant at the QE, I will still have a firm of students and they will accompany me on the ward rounds. We may do some special rounds, we may do some bedside teaching. So some of those elements are still true. So a bit of geography, you're here, University Hospital Birmingham, the QE, quite a long process, it's only a few hundred yards away, and you've obviously seen the big sort of towers in the sky, whatever else, and our students certainly, of course, appreciate being just next door to this world-class facility. But we go to these other teaching trusts around the region. Now, I think one of the differences from us and sort of perhaps some of the London medical schools is that actually the majority of our teaching trusts are within very easy commuting distance. So most of our students actually commute to all of these. Hereford a bit further away, but when we started using Hereford Teaching Trust, we made sure that the trains to Hereford stopped at the university station, so now it's only an hour away on the train, and so whilst our students are offered accommodation at some of the more distant trusts, they will often come back, for example, if they've got evening activities. That's slightly different from London schools, where people may spend much more time outside, and having to stay away from campus. I was going to put the GP practice on there, but it looked like smallpox, so I didn't. Learning options in hospital, as I say, the medical team will have something, but these days we're much more making use of the multi-professional team, so there may be nurse specialists, pharmacists, others that get involved in teaching, and then a cadre of junior doctors who take some time out and what we call clinical teaching fellow. Very important to underpin and add some value to what's happening generally in teaching. Again, there's still independent learning out in the hospitals and negotiating learning opportunities. We'll say to the students, this is an opportunity where if you're seeing a patient, perhaps they're due to go for an operation, they're having scans, they're having procedures, whatever else, then go and watch them. And that's all freely available. And our students spend a lot of time by watching, doing, sometimes even by teaching others. And physios get quite involved in teaching. So loads of opportunities in the hospitals. There's a QE. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about the QE. I won't make a short video of this. But about 7,000 employees providing district general hospital services to South Birmingham, but regional services and in fact national services much beyond that. So we have the regional centre for the major trauma centre here, regional burns and plastics, neuroscience, cancer, the largest solid organ transplant unit in Europe, the largest intensive care unit with 130 beds in one space, again, in Europe. So with about 1,300 beds, it's a pretty large place that offers lots of specialist services, and of course, our students will all get exposure, as I say, through the QE at some point. Now a bit about bedside work there. Think about some of other clinical activities. I mentioned the elective, so this is students elected. Our students, some of them will actually decide to stay locally or regionally. They may pursue some research projects, but again, this is an opportunity for our students to go all around the world, and it's adjacent to some holidays, so they'll often put a vacation on that as well. But they get lots of wide experience, sometimes in developing countries, and get very involved in the healthcare there. Other things I mentioned briefly about our skills passport, clearly to be able to be proficient at doing various skills is very important. And so again, we work quite closely to try and make sure that all of our students are competent at those things that they need to be able to do as a junior doctor. Like you may see, we have a simulation facility here, and so they may do part skill simulation on, for example, being able to take blood gases from a wrist in a plastic arm or whatever else, before, of course, they go out and do it in real practice. But the other thing about simulation is it now enables us to, for example, test the students in situations that they may not see. So, for example, anaphylactic shock, they may not see a case like that whilst they're here, but we need to make sure they're proficient at that. So we'll embed them in a simulation suite, something like this. So the operator behind the window, actually with one of the high-fidelity mannequins, to actually be able to try and make sure that they're able to safe and competent to undertake those treatments of those conditions. And here on the right, you see some work that I tend to do, because we have so many of the different professions in the college. Here we actually have one of the physiotherapy students working with medical students, and we've got some of the nursing students in the background, all working together in these professional simulations, where actually you can really concentrate on issues such as team working skills and paperwork. As you can see, the shuffling of paper, typical of the NHS here. But that's all in a simulated environment. That's in one of our wards here in the college. Exams, we don't like exams, we better just have one slide on them, shouldn't we, just to say. So, types of assessments, there's fairly similar assessments. So we don't have much in the way of essay writing here, but we do have, for example, quite a lot of multiple choice questions, some extended matching questions, which are extensions of multiple choice, and some short answer questions. But because this often tests at a bottom, sort of lower down the sort of educational domain, then we also have to try and make sure that we have placement activities and we have reports from our consultants and the rest of the medical team on how well students are doing. The portfolio activities that we often take into account in the procedural skills passport, where again they collect evidence that they've undertaken these skills. And then lastly, what we call our objective structured clinical exams. These are bedside examinations where, for example, examining this patient with a stoma, and here is a case-based discussion that I'm having with this student now in the hospital. So these will tend to be taken in the hospital trust, and they occur at the end of second, third, fourth, and fifth year OSCE clinical exams. So I mentioned keeping the curriculum up to date. I'm not very up to date with my BMJ reading, it's 1956, whatever else, but I like this from George Pickering. I'll show this. This is one. The dinner, whatever else, and the Dean of Harvard said, my students are dismayed when I say to them half of what you're taught to medical students will in 10 years be shown to be wrong. The trouble is, none of your teachers knows which half. So, I mean, it's a slight truism. Things move on, as I say, and that's why I need to try and look at technology and look at changes in the curriculum and make sure we're up to date. I'm quite worried about, in general, about the aging population, not just myself, but, you know, thinking about frailty and dealing with actually the very frail elderly is something that's really been we've been thinking about. We can all treat according to the evidence basis, but actually is that necessarily the right thing? So actually we've got a small working group looking at that and trying to see how that embeds. And I think that those sorts of things are really important to us, you know, the human culture as well as educators. The other thing is that information advances rapidly. So here we are, the bottom line, whatever it is here, it's about 500,000 new articles published now. PubMed, which is a major database, whatever else, that's a huge amount of evidence that therefore we need to embed somehow within the curriculum, and also try and make sure that our students year on year are kept up to date. Luckily we have sort of technology at our hands or whatever else, and we have a lot of e-books and other things so that our students can access the most up-to-date rich information for just-in-time learning. We point them towards apps and we provide sort of e-learning materials for them in there. And we also have, an expert virtual learning environment, Canvas, which is we're the first UK university to use this North American online e-learning system. And actually, this has been really good because it enables us to interact. We can mark our students' essays and give video feedback. We can actually have conferences in the evenings that students will dial into. It's a fantastic system that's been really helpful in the last few years of keeping things up to date. Just innovation and. As I say, IT will change things. Our students are digital natives. I wasn't necessarily, I think I'm a digital immigrant in this way. Mainly to show this with a cartoon here. You see, I hear reggae rhythms, disco drums, deep thumping, hip hop, toe tapping, western swing, and 80s techno beats. I think your pacemaker is stuck on the shuffle. So we need to keep up to date. And actually, these days, again, we try to. We've got the Dean has a blog. He doesn't actually have a tweet stream, but I do have a tweet stream at UE. UOBMBCHB is the tweet stream, and again through not just email but through other social media methods we try and make sure our students are aware of activities that are going on, extracurricular activities, etc. etc. So nearly at the end, don't worry. Final thoughts. It was once said medicine used to be simple, ineffective and relatively safe, it's now complex, effective and potentially dangerous. I think the way that we practice medicine now means that we have to, as I say, my most important mission is to create safe and competent doctors because of the complexity of health. So this is the vision of the Dean, and the Dean's team, as he calls his vice deans and train the very best doctors. So we need to be compliant with the GMC, but we also need to provide a quality, innovative educational experience. We also hope that as a programme we can really enhance the student experience, but importantly prepare them to be 21st century doctors, and also, as I say, fit for whatever career they decide to choose. Safe and sensible, well equipped, thirst for knowledge, and really start them off very well.